Rolling Stone magazine called Oh Mercy, quote, the strongest album from the singer-songwriter in a decade. Bob Dylan hired Daniel Lanois to produce the record based on a suggestion from Bono of U2. And the rest, as they say, is history. Well, this week, Daniel Lanois has joined me in the studio to reflect on some of the most memorable albums he's produced. And this week, he'll be inducted into the Canadian Music Industry Hall of Fame. And it is certainly my pleasure to welcome Daniel Lanois back into the Radio 2 Drive studio.
Very nice to be here with you today.
Now, you interrupted working on your own album, Acadie, to work with Bob Dylan on his record. So what did it mean to you to have a chance to work with him?
Well, to have a chance to work with one of the national treasures of America was a big thrill for me, you know, as a Canadian kid. As it turns out, Bob was on the road at the time, and I had a studio set up in New Orleans because I was recording the Neville Brothers. We made a record called Yellow Moon, a very, very good and strong record. Bob stopped in. We played him a couple of tracks, and he was really excited about what was going on because we had created our own environment in this whole funky place on St. Charles in New Orleans. And we had recorded two of his songs. Aaron Neville wanted to record the Ballad of Hollis Brown and another song of Bob's called God on Our Side.
Right.
And I played Bob these two songs, and he was a bit quiet. He looked up, he says, "That sounds like a record." And that was a big compliment coming mm-hmm. from Bob. I think he understood that we'd captured a great emotion from one of America's great singers, Aaron Neville, and that we were able to do it in quite a humble environment. And there was not a lot of razzmatazz. It was pretty much the sleeves rolled up and let's get the job done. So I think he knew that my little Canadian team was quite potent at that time.
Right. So when he stopped by the studio there in New Orleans during the recording of the Neville Brothers record, were you meeting him for the first time then, or had you met before?
That was the first time I met Bob. Was in New Orleans. That's right.
It must have been a great thrill. You're often praised for your ability to bring out the best in an artist. So I'm wondering how you went about that with somebody like Bob Dylan. I mean, an icon who had already been in the business for about 30 years at that point. I mean, I can't help but wonder if there was any sort of sense of intimidation, or was it more just like you said, well, look, we've got a job to do here. I'm going to roll up my sleeves and just get busy.
I'm intimidated every day of my life.
Right.
I'm a very insecure person. The milkman comes to the door, should there be such a person left on the planet,
right,
and I get intimidated.
Right, okay.
Shall I take the 2% or the whole? Bob certainly recognized that we were committed.
Right.
And it's hard to come by to be committed to. I wouldn't wish it upon anyone, but I'm very committed, and I live and breathe my work. And I think Bob really felt that we had built something for the Neville brothers. When he visited us in New Orleans, we had actually built a studio for the brothers. This was not just a generic studio down the street. We'd rented a building. I brought in my Canadian team. I bought the equipment for the project. You know, it was designed for the Neville brothers because I loved them and I wanted to make a masterpiece with them. And Bob felt that when he came in.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he just decided that these people are a mother load of sorts. And I think I'm happy to be operating, to jump on their train, Lanois' train, for a while.
Yeah, right.
And he agreed. I said, let's huddle up in the spring. I said, I'll look after everything. I'll get a building. I'll put a nice little band together, all the equipment, instruments. Just turn up with your songs. And that's what he did. He just turned up with pieces of paper. And we got on with the record. The Neville brothers lived just down the street, so at any time we could bring in Mean Willie Green on the drums and whoever else, maybe Cyril would come in and sing some backups or play the congas and so on.
Well, and those are some heavy guys to be able to call on. That's
yes,
a huge plus.
Very, very great people. Very, very great.
And so you mentioned that he showed up and he's got the songs, he's got his pieces of paper. Was it immediately to work, or was there a period at all of discussion, philosophizing, where ideas, did you talk before setting down to work, or did you jump right in?
Well, I had been to Bob's house somewhere between the initial meeting and the beginning of the session, and he had played me a few songs, so I was a bit familiar with what he had. He already had a song most of the time,
right,
which I loved. Beautiful love song. I think it goes, most of the time I'm clear focused all around. Most of the time I can keep both feet on the ground. I can handle whatever I stumble upon. I don't even notice she's gone most of the time. So, and I thought that was a very tender way of looking at love and looking at missing somebody. And it's, so that was kind of, that was the beginning of it. And then he had, had a few others that, had a little rock and roll song called Everything's Broken, broken plates, broken idols, broken treaties. Anytime you go away, everything's broken. There's a sentiment of the song. So another love song, I thought, okay, we're on to something here. But aside from that, that was, we saw him a few months later when he turned up on the doorstep. Mm-hmm. And that was it. That was the beginning of it.
In Bob Dylan's, autobiographical work, we'll call it, he wrote that the sessions for Oh Mercy were difficult at times and that he wasn't always happy with the results, but then the reviews were overwhelmingly positive and clearly it all worked out very nicely in the end. So, I'm curious to know what sort of challenges you ran into along the way, and how they were dealt with, and if dealing with them was easy or difficult.
Well, simply put, Bob was used to having a band around him.